Acts chapter 20, and this is our 12th and final discussion of church government. We're going to tie up some loose ends, dealing with some more practical matters, and I've entitled the sermon Judgment and Discipline, discussing different aspects of the office of elder, what needs to be done. And I'll be reading from from Acts chapter 20, beginning at verse 17. And from Miletus, he sent to Ephesus and called the elders of the church. And when they were come to him, he said unto them, "You know from the first day that I came unto Asia, after what manner I have been with you at all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility of mind, with many tears and temptations, which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews. And how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, but have showed you, and have taught you publicly and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. And now behold, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there." And so on and so forth. And then I jump down to 28. "Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Spirit hath made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he has purchased with his own blood. For I know this, that after my departure shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. Therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone day and night with tears. And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them that are sanctified." In our discussion of the office of elder, we noted that they must have the ability to teach as well as rule or govern or lead. 1 Timothy 3, 2-5. A crucial aspect of teaching and ruling concerns counseling, rendering judgments in disputes between Christians, 1 Corinthians 6, 1-3, and disciplining those who refuse to obey instructions and commands to repent of sin, Matthew 18, 15 and following. In this section, we will consider these duties to help us understand what elders need to be doing to be effective. So, more practical matters. Counseling is unlike preaching in that it is directed to a Christian individual or small group of individuals, for example, a married couple or a family or a few believers involved in a dispute, and is interactive or more personal. Okay, so it is in class with teaching, but it's a different kind of teaching. It is like preaching in that it involves teaching out of the Word of God, making personal applications and confronting, admonishing, or correcting those who are in error doctrinally or regarding behavior. Good preachers ought to make good counseling, good counselors, and vice versa. If you're good at applying the Word of God in a preaching situation, you ought to be good at applying the Word of God in an individual situation. In fact, each of these activities ought to support, reinforce, and involve the other. Those who apply the Word individually learn biblical wisdom through concrete cases, and thus can be more effective at both explaining and applying an applicatory teaching. Just as the change that God requires is the goal of all biblical counseling, so too is that change is the goal of all truly scriptural preaching. Each task, in turn, has as its common end the glory of God through the sanctification of God's sheep. It is important. It needs to be stressed. And we can thank J. Adams for stressing it in the modern era. Counseling is often treated differently than preaching in many in that many evangelicals, unfortunately, have mixed psychology and secular concepts of problem solving into their methodology. And that's totally, totally wrong and unscriptural, and you ought to read J. Adams' Competent to Counsel and the Christian Counselor's Manual, where he deals with all that. Everything we need is in the Word of God, 2 Timothy 3:16 following. But all such thinking is unbiblical and dangerous. It is a denial of the perfection and sufficiency of Scripture. Paul says, and here's that passage, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, "All Scripture is given by inspiration of God." That is, it is breathed out by God. A better translation would be expiration of God. and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. And counseling is a good work, if it's biblical. The word reproof refers to warnings that are based on the Bible. It refers to the negative side of counseling. Errors, dangers, and bad conduct must not only be exposed, but the consequences of heterodox teaching and living must also be pointed out. So in counseling, as in preaching, you shed light on bad behavior or bad doctrine and give the why, and then you have to give the implications of non-repentance, covenant sanctions, church discipline, and so forth. Such things must be refuted and properly defined in the spirit of Christian love. But biblical love does not mean that teaching or discipline is compromised, watered down, or ignored. Unfortunately, that's common today, where people think that Christian love means, hey, yeah, Bob's got a problem here. Just overlook it. No big deal. No big deal. The Greek word, elenko, is translated as reprove, rebuke, convince, convict, and tell one's fault. It means to confront or rebuke a brother with the truth, with the goal of bringing conviction of sin, confession, and repentance. A similar word is nutheteo, to warn, to confront. It says in Colossians 1:28 and other passages, which refers to a verbal confrontation in which a change in beliefs, attitudes, and behavior is brought about by the application of specific scripture passages. For the Christian, confrontation flows from love and concern about real sin or error, not a desire to get even or seek revenge. Never should be from that standpoint. The word correction emphasizes the positive side of counseling. Not only must the sinner be warned to leave the wrong path, but he must also be directed to the right or straight path. And we see this especially in places like Ephesians chapter 4. Put off lying. Replace it with biblical truth and love. Put off stealing. Go get a job. Make enough money that you not only can support yourself, but you can help others. The put off, put on principle. Don't do this. Get rid of this. Repent of this. But replace it with this. The whole Christian life of sanctification is one of putting off that which is displeasing to God or contrary to God's law and replacing it with a godly counterpart that glorifies God and sets one apart from this evil world system. Reproving, correcting, and teaching in general has as its goal training in righteousness. Christian teaching is not simply done to satisfy one's theological curiosity. The point is spiritual discipline and progressive growth and sanctification. The elders of the church are there so that Christians may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Church members are not neutral observers or referees, but active participants in establishing the kingdom of God on earth and the Christian reconstruction of society. Over 20 years ago, one of my first jobs was to plant a church in Michigan, and there was only one family there. I don't know why they thought this was a good idea, but there was one family. And so I get there, and the family says, okay, go plant a church. Have fun. Now, the job of the people in the church is to evangelize and to work on their neighbors and to work the web of influences. And the church, the pastor and the elders train the people to do good works, which involves witnessing and many other things. But they're more like coaches of the football players. And the modern view of many people is that the people sit in the stands and they watch the coaches battle it out. The elders must function as a court to settle disputes among believers in disciplinary cases. And by the way, a fundamental concept of biblical leadership has in view the training, challenging, and equipping of the whole flock for ministry. And we see that throughout the New Testament. The The purpose of church is not simply to get together to worship God. The purpose of the church, and I'm talking about the people, is training so all the people can minister to relatives, minister to acquaintances, minister to people at work, in the sense of teaching them the gospel and trying to help society, be a salt to salt and light to culture. The elders must also function as a court. Paul recognized that Roman courts were unjust because they were rooted in a pagan world and life view. Therefore, he said, this is 1 Corinthians 6:1, dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unrighteous and not before the saints. The statement, dare any of you, reveals that Paul is horrified. He's absolutely horrified by the thought of Christians going before pagans to settle disputes. The verb judge or go to law, krino, has the sense of bringing something for judgment. Now, Paul here is merely reflecting the teaching of the Old Testament, where people are commanded to settle disputes for the elders of the people. That is the congregation of the Lord. Now, obviously, American courts are not as bad as Roman courts because of our nation's Christian heritage. But our country has become so secularized and paganized that Paul's statement still applies to today. Believers who have a quarrel or a dispute over property or, you know, so-and-so let me his lawnmower, he didn't give it back or whatever, they have to go to the elders, not go to a civil court and sue each other. Paul's command assumes that justice is rooted in the biblical law order and that those making decisions and disputes between Christians ought to be regenerated and be familiar with the Word of God. You're not going to get that in an American court. You're just not. Sadly, you're not going to get that in a lot of church courts today either, but that's not the point. That's due to declension. If a church member refuses to abide by a just decision of the church court, they must be excommunicated and treated as a heathen and a tax collector, Matthew 18:17. Then the remaining Christian party is free to sue the excommunicated person or persons in a heathen civil court. So once they're excommunicated, then you're free to take them to court if you want to try to get money out of them, because the church can't get involved in that. It takes some kind of a civil authority. It takes the sword to get money out of people. The church doesn't carry the sword. Same thing with a situation where, let's say, a man is married to a woman and she leaves him. He has to go through the series of steps until she's excommunicated. Once she's excommunicated, then he's free to divorce her and remarry. But he has to go to the church first and go through the necessary steps of discipline until she's excommunicated. Then he can treat her as a heathen and a publican. The Apostle Paul, on more than one occasion, Acts 16, 37-39 and 25, 10-12, used the Roman courts to fight against injustice and unlawful persecution by the heathen and the apostate Jews. So he availed the courts when it was to his benefit, but not against other Christians, but against pagans and apostates. The Apostle's reason for not going before the pagan courts is eschatological. It's very interesting. The saints, we are told, will judge the world, 1 Corinthians 6:2. Now, this statement is interpreted in two different ways. One, and this is, I think, the favorable view, is that a time is coming when the saints will judge and rule the nations and the peoples of the world. Thus, in effect, Paul is saying, in light of the fact that the gospel will be victorious and Christians will possess all the key places of authority in society, you need to learn to judge with biblical wisdom and righteous judgment in the present. You need to know your Bibles. You need to know biblical wisdom. You need to know how to apply the Bible and biblical law to current situations in the church. For if you can't do that, how are you going to judge, be civil judges, and have positions of authority in the future when Christians take over the world through the preaching of the gospel? This view is an implication of the Old Testament prophetic message of victory in time and on earth before the second coming. It also, I know dispensationalists and premillennialists apply that to the supposed future 1,000-year millennium after Christ returns, which we all know is unbiblical nonsense. and you can read my book on premillennialism online. It also reflects specific passages such as the Greek Septuagint version of Daniel 7:22. Judgment was given to the saints of the Most High. It also calls to mind Jesus' promise to the disciples in Matthew 19:28. Assuredly, I say to you that in the regeneration, when the Son of Man sits on the throne of his glory, okay, he's sitting on the throne of his glory, not on earth, but in heaven. You who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And of course, there's all this intertestamental literature of the Jews where they talk about the saints ruling the world. Now, their problem was not in thinking the saints would rule the world. Their problem was in applying it to the first coming of Christ instead of after his resurrection. Although this implies elders judging among the Christian community, believers will not hold the robes of society until the majority of people are converted to Christ. Okay, that's, I think, the preferable view. A second view is that the saints will participate somehow in the final judgment at the second coming of Christ. That's a very popular view. It might even be the majority view. How that would take place, I have no idea, but it's possible. The entire anti-God system of things will be judged, and in some way, God will involve his people in this process. It is shameful, therefore, Paul says, not to be able to judge such trivial matters before the church. Now, the teaching of Paul here is profound. Christians must handle their own problems, offenses, and disputes in-house, and must do so effectively, wisely, and justly, for they will eventually govern the world. That's what Paul's saying. This teaching tells us that churches must take the eldership much more seriously. As an office of judgment, the elders must see themselves as officers of God's law. They must become experts in Christian ethics and understand how to apply God's law to every area of life. And I don't see that very much today. I see a lot of pragmatism. And even worse, I see a lot of Romanism. Well, I'm the elder and you better do what I say. And then I say, well, I'd be happy to do what you say. Just explain to me why from the Bible. Because what you say doesn't make any sense. If you explain it to me from the Bible, I'll be happy to submit to that. No, I'm the elder. Do what I say. Elders must be trained in the whole law. For when nations covenant with Christ, they will be called to apply the law to all the world. As imperial agents of Christ, their king, they will establish justice in the land as arbitrary humanistic law is replaced by biblical law. So that's an incredible eschatological challenge to the church that we ought to meditate on. The closer that the eldership is tied to the Word of God and Christian ethics, the more just and righteous will be their judgment. And remember, what did Paul call the unbelievers, the judges of the unbelievers? He said they were unrighteous, unjust. In our day, when the law of God is denied and denigrated because of the influence of dispensationalism and the gross misunderstanding of the Westminster Confession of Faith on the law, what does the Westminster Confession say? That the judicial law is abrogated except the general equity thereof. What does that mean? It's a very easy, quick way of saying that the judicial law is abrogated except universal moral laws that were applied outside of Israel. They're not abrogated. They still apply. And that's commonly misinterpreted as the whole judicial law is done away, except you might find a few general, very esoteric, vague principles in those laws that you can apply. That's not what it says. What is universal and what applied to the Gentile nations, for example, Leviticus 18, that still applies. Not some general, vague principle. And by the way, the word principle simply is another word for law. When people get rid of the law, the eldership often becomes pragmatic, arbitrary, and unjust. If people aren't supposed to submit to their elders because they're nice guys or they wear nice suits and ties. They're to submit to the elders because they're experts in the law of God and they're giving biblical instruction. It's not a raw authority like Roman Catholic priests. these are people who are telling you what the Word of God says and why you need to obey it, based on the Word of God, not personal opinion. Biblical wisdom is not what seems right to an old man, but is the application of God's law to specific situations in life. That's biblical wisdom. For generations, the office of elder has been in serious decline because its importance and true functions have been ignored. In many churches, it became, by 1900, merely an honor accorded to prominent members. And I've been in the PCA and the OPC. I've been in churches where, hey, you know, and they're talking, the elders are, the session's talking about, yeah, we need another elder. Who are we going to get? Oh, well, Bob over there, he's a good businessman. He makes a lot of money. He comes to church every week. Yeah, he'll make a great elder. Well, that's not enough. And that's the way the elders are often picked today, and that's just not a good way to pick elders. Now, if you want to pick Bob and say, Bob, you're going to go through a two-year training program in theology and biblical interpretation and counseling, then if you feel called to the eldership and you're willing to do that and become an elder, that's another matter. But that's not what's going on. People are made elders who are complete imbeciles, who don't know the Word of God and who don't know theology, and they're making and voting on critical matters of doctrine and discipline. The function of the elder became largely that of a judge sitting in a monthly review on the minister and sometimes dealing with matters concerning the building and the premises. Very little was expected of elders, and thus elders were usually capable of very little. The incompetency of the eldership is shocking and is a major reason for the widespread declension in our day. If elders knew doctrine, like they should, do you think that the canard would have been let off the hook in the OPC in 2002? No. The elders would have told the church bureaucrats and the professors at Westminster Seminary that they were giving unbiblical, irrational arguments, and they would have outvoted them. And canard would be history, at least in the OPC. He could go join himself to Crick. He could go join himself to Doug Wilson and those heretics. Well, that brings us to our next topic, which is church discipline. Close related to the elders as judges is their duty to handle cases of church discipline. To do this task properly, there are a number of things to consider. First, elders must first make sure that all of the biblical directions regarding the proper steps and procedures for discipline have been followed. That's number one. The first thing that has to be done. These steps or procedures are not voluntary, they're not optional. The Lord Jesus Christ and the inspired apostles to tell us to do them, yet they are usually ignored today by church courts. These steps or directions are found in a number of passages that are clear and simple in their directions. We'll look at two of them. In Matthew chapter 5, 23 to 24, we learn that each individual Christian, and this is very interesting, in particular, and in the narrative, Jesus is teaching, and he's talking in the second person, plural, you, over and over, you, plural, you, plural, you, plural. And he gets to this, and right here, and he switches to you, singular. So he's emphasizing that you, as an individual Christian, are responsible to do this. Every Christian is responsible to seek reconciliation with a Christian that he may have offended. Let me read the passage. 5:23-24. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar, you're about to render worship, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift at the altar and go your way. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Now, the word therefore indicates that this teaching follows logically from his previous statement about unlawful anger and name-calling, verses 21-22. Our attitude towards other Christians must be one of biblical love and not anger and hatred. Well, I'm going to get even with that guy. I'm going to destroy him. That's not the attitude of a Christian. Therefore, reconciliation, peace, and a restoration of fellowship must be sought with a brother who thinks that we have wronged him before we attend public worship, and especially before we attend the Holy Supper. As John says, this is 1 John 20b and 21, he who does not love his brother whom he has seen How can he love God whom he has not seen? And this commandment we have from the beginning, that he who loves God must love his brother also. Here's what Paul says in this is from Ephesians 4, 2 to 3 and 31 to 32. Here's what Paul says. Paul says that we must conduct ourselves, quote, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you, with all malice. And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. You don't see that. A lot of times you don't see that in the church. We're not to try to get even. We're trying to love our brother and make and cause him to repent and reconcile. If he's guilty, if we're wrong, we have to admit we're wrong and reconcile. We have to seek reconciliation. That's how unity is accorded. All Christians, whether the one wronged, Matthew 18, 15 and following, or the one who may have wronged another, are to resolve such situations so that a full reconciliation takes place. You got to do everything you can to have full reconciliation. If someone's not willing to repent and you've done your duty, you've done your duty. But you got to try, and you have to really try hard. There are to be no loose ends or situations of unforgiveness in the Church of Christ. When professing Christians refuse to forgive or simply cut someone off without seeking a full reconciliation, they are acting like the heathen. And that's happened to me many times. You know, I had many years ago, I had a sermon where I was talking about having a drink, an alcoholic beverage, and some legalistic person yelled and screamed at me after church. I never saw him ever again. He had been a member for quite a while. I had another sermon where I criticized the use of grape juice and thimbles. Guy got super angry at me, yelled at me on the phone. He was done. That's nonsense. That's unchristian. It's pagan. By now you may be thinking, well, what does this have to do with the elders and church discipline? Well, the elders must be ready to deal with this situation, which is more common than you may think, because we're all sinners, when reconciliation cannot be achieved by the two parties. See, the Bible doesn't teach loose ends. In fact, the Bible teaches you're to settle problems of anger that very day if you can. And this passage, you need to settle a situation where you may have offended somebody. You really got to try to settle it by next Sunday, by the next time you have public worship. Whenever there is a problem, Jesus expects Christians to be mature and obedient and resolve it on a personal level. But at times, professing Christians do not think biblically or are simply stubborn and unforgiving. In such a situation, the elders have a responsibility to analyze the situation and either order the offender to repent and acknowledge his sin, if he has refused to do so, or to order the offended party who is refusing to reconcile to forgive and forget. Because I've seen people that are completely irrational and done things that are totally unbiblical and justifiable and will not repent. Well, that's when you go to the elders and let them straighten it out. And then you submit to what the elders say, unless they're obviously unscriptural. You have to submit to what the elders say. And then there's reconciliation and you have to forgive and forget. Unfortunately, what a lot of people do who are angry and are acting like a heathen, they just leave the church. Totally unbiblical. Totally ungodly. Totally unholy, totally sinful to do that. Sadly, people who are legalistic jerks or self-righteous or unforgiving will often simply reject the authority of the session and go to another church. Others who do not want to repent will often do the same. Biblical Christians who are really godly will respect their elders and always seek to do things in a decent and orderly fashion. Okay, we live in an age where elders are not respected. Now, part of the reason is elders, most of them are unqualified today. But elders need to be respected and obeyed. they will not object to, but will welcome attempts to bring about reconciliation or the need to implement biblical discipline. If a Christian really believes that a session has rendered an unbiblical or unjust verdict, which ought to be rare, they should not act like a heathen and cut and run, but should appeal to the presbytery. That's what a presbytery is for. And I've seen situations, I've been in the OPC, the PCA, and the RPCNA, and I've seen situations where sessions did stuff that was super stupid, totally stupid, and they were rebuked by presbytery when it was taken up the ladder. They were rebuked. Usually that occurs. That's why the system, the Presbyterian system of graduated courts, is so wonderful. If you're a Baptist or a Congregationalist, you can't do that. You're just stuck with these incompetent knuckleheads. But if you're a Presbyterian, you can take it up the ladder. You can take it up the ladder. Moreover, churches should never receive Christians into their membership who have left the church for the wrong reasons. That's a big problem today. Let us not forget that problems in this area usually arise from a lack of Christian love. People who are full of hate and refuse to forgive are not real Christians. That's what the Bible says. What did Jesus say in Matthew 6? Father, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. If you're Christian, you're forgiving. If you're not Christian, you're not forgiving. And if you're not forgiving, don't expect God to forgive you. Because we've been forgiven a Mount Everest of sin and guilt. And God only expects us to forgive a few stupid sins of our brothers. If we've been forgiven a Mount Everest of guilt and sin, we ought to be able to reconcile and forgive a little anthill of sin against us. People who are full of hate and refuse to forgive are not real Christians. Jesus says, Luke 17:4. This is great, and this is reflective of from the Sermon on the Mount. Actually, it's reflective of Matthew 18. Take heed to yourselves. If your brother sins against you, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you seven times in a day, and seven times in a day returns to you saying, I repent, you shall forgive him. What is Jesus saying there? He's saying, don't look for reasons not to forgive. Don't be a legalistic jerk. Don't be a Pharisee. Cut your brother the benefit of the doubt and forgive him and forget it. Be loving. Be merciful. Be kind, like God. And then number two, in Matthew 18, 15 and following, Jesus turns the tables and requires the offended party to go to the one who allegedly committed sin to seek repentance and reconciliation. Moreover, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. That is face to face, in person, not on the internet, not in a letter, and not even in a phone call unless the guy's in the Antarctica or something. If he hears you, you have gained your brother. But if he will not hear, take with you one or two more, that is witnesses from Deuteronomy 19. By the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word shall be established. And if he refuses to hear them, tell it to the church, that is the session, the elders. But if he refuses even to hear the church, let him be like to you like a heathen and a tax collector. That's verses 15 to 17. Elders need to train church members that when a private offense occurs, they are not to run to the session and complain. That happens all the time. Or even worse, much worse, they are not to gossip about it to others, spread it all around. So-and-so's a real jerk, man. He did this. And they usually do it in this phony, pharisaical spirituality. Oh, I'm really concerned about our church. I'm really concerned about so-and-so. He did this and he did that. Oh, he's really evil. I want you to hate him like I hate him. That's not biblical, folks, but it happens all the time. This teaching from our Lord is very simple, yet it is rarely followed. Christians who do not follow it should be rebuked by the session in order to follow it to the letter. If somebody comes to me and says, oh, so-and-so said this or so-and-so did that. And I said, well, did you talk to him about it? Did you follow Matthew 18? No. Well, go follow Matthew 18. If you can't get it resolved, bring it to the session. If you need a witness, I'll be a witness if you need a witness. Go obey Scripture. Follow Matthew 18. We have to train Christians. Elders are to train Christians how to communicate biblically and seek reconciliation biblically, and there'd be a lot less fighting and division and problems in the church. Instead, matters are unlawfully made public through gossip, and then sessions will treat the sin as a public matter. This happens all the time. People gossip about it, and they make it public, and then the session, instead of rebuking the person who gossiped and said, oh, no, you're not going to get away with that, you go apologize, and you follow Matthew 18. They go, well, it's already public. We have to treat it as a public matter. So they reward the gossip. They reward the gossiper, and they teach people to gossip. That happens all the time. It ought not to happen at all. The person who gossiped needs to be rebuked for the gossip publicly if necessary, and then they need to make amends and go follow Matthew 18. In addition, by following all the steps of Matthew 18, Christians are taught how to confront sin and solve problems and thus become wiser and more competent to counsel over time. Remember, the job of elders is to train Christians to be better Christians, to train Christians to be competent to counsel, to train Christians in progressive sanctification, to train Christians to have better unity, to train Christians in doctrine so you can trust them. So you know if they hear something kooky from somebody, they're not going to run off and adopt it. You train them to be better Christians, not to remain babies the rest of their life. Further, they learn the importance of reconciliation and forgiveness. What does the Bible teach? The Bible teaches the moment somebody sins against you, there's a sin. I got to deal with it right away. And I got to seek reconciliation. We're going to deal with this. That's what the Bible teaches. You deal with it one sin at a time. You know what people do? Oh, he sinned. They make a record of it. They don't do anything about it. There's no reconciliation. Then the guy sins the week later. Oh, here's another sin. Then pretty soon the guy's got a list of 100 sins. Boy, I really hate this guy. And then they're gossiping all about it. This guy did this, he did this. This guy's a reprobate. And then there's the peace of the church is disturbed. You deal with one sin at a time as it happens until there's full reconciliation or discipline if necessary, and the church is free of all the garbage. Here's the illustration. Any of you have had small children, and you've got your box of toys over there. Sometimes you'll have two or three boxes of toys. And you get up in the morning, and the house is perfectly clean. And the kids get the toys out, and they play. Well, at the end of the day, what do? Well, you put all the toys away. Can you imagine what your house would look like if you never picked up the toys? Well, that's what Christ is teaching here. The church, we don't want to have tons of problems. We deal with them one problem at a time, one sin at a time, so the house remains clean. The church remains free of gossip. The church remains free of schism. The church remains free of conflict because Christians are dealing with sins as they arise. Anybody who comes with a list of sins, you did this, you did this, you did this, you did this, ought to be rebuked and disciplined because that is totally unchristian. If you have a problem with somebody, you either deal with it. If you're not willing to do with it because you're a coward, then you have to cover it with love and don't bring it up ever again to yourself or anyone else. But if you think it's really serious and needs to be dealt with, you got to go to that person and deal with it face to face. These are very simple things. They're very simple things. The only reason I'm going over it is because they're so widely disobeyed today. They learn the importance of reconciliation and forgiveness. When sessions allow gossip, bitterness, and problems to fester, they are encouraging the sheep to remain incompetent and immature. I've been in churches where, the preaching was so bad, they treat people like they're 5 years old, and the discipline was so bad. It's like, do they want everybody to remain little babies the rest of their life and just have a little cup of milk? The elders, especially teaching elders, are to train God's people under their care to have a biblical, speedy, full reconciliation of all personal differences and conflict between church members. If we do that, we should have peace. If somebody becomes a heretic and there's a problem and they don't repent and they got to be kicked out, we did our duty. We followed the steps. We did everything we could. If somebody's guilty of immorality and the steps are followed and they don't repent and they're excommunicated, we did our duty. But you don't sweep things under the rug and make lists on people and gossip about them behind their back. We don't do that. It doesn't accomplish anything but cause schism and bitterness and hatred. When matters do come before the session, witnesses must be questioned and found to be trustworthy. And if you study anything about the Sanhedrin and Jewish law, the witnesses were interviewed and questioned before they were allowed to be witnesses. They didn't allow any old Joe Schmo get up there and talk. People with a history of lying or obviously have an axe to grind are not reliable witnesses. Matthew 18 assumes that witnesses are Christians in good standing and not atheists or excommunicates. We're talking about brothers here. Do you know in an American court, you know, they do that little ritual where they put the hand on the Bible and they swear to tell the truth before God? Well, the reason for that is very old. I don't agree with the ritual of putting the hand on the Bible, but the swearing there, the assumption there is if you're not a Christian and or if you're an atheist, you're not a trustworthy witness. Why should you tell the truth if you don't believe in God, if you don't believe there's a law, if you don't believe there's a judgment? Why should you tell the truth? You don't really care. That's why that swearing is there. It's an oath to tell the truth before God, Jehovah. Moreover, church members who have left the church or in rebellion or who are refusing to submit to the elders are disqualified immediately as reliable witnesses. They're not allowed to testify. And that is a requirement, I believe, for my days in the OPC. You cut and run, you're not allowed to come back and start bringing charges against the elders and people in the church because you're in rebellion. If you stay and follow Matthew 18, you're allowed to deal with it. But if you cut and run, why should you be allowed to throw stones? You're in rebellion against God. You're not submitting to the elders. Who are you to testify and bring charges? And I think that's a policy in the OPC, and I think it's a great policy. You got to stay until the matter's resolved. If you leave after the matter's resolved and the elders are incompetent boobs and you leave in an orderly way, fine. But you did your duty. You saw it through. You did it decently and in order, and you followed all the steps required by Scripture. Remember, Scripture, we're not required to submit to the elders if they tell us to sin or do something wrong. Same thing with wives. You submit to your husband in the Lord. That means if he tells you to rob a bank, you tell him no. Whenever accusations of wrong are made, they must be defined or explained and then proved directly out of the Word of God. If the session determines guilt in the matter, the guilty party must understand why and must be given an opportunity to repent before being barred from the table. Let me just quickly read Rush Dooney's comments on... I've preached on Matthew 18:15. So I wanted something new, and here's a really good quote from Rush Dooney and his Institutes. Now turning now to church chastisement, the central passage is Matthew 18:15-20, which is usually assumed to be the basis of discipline. In reality, the procedure outlined simply determines if the wrongdoer is amenable to chastisement, that is, if there is any discipline of the word in his or her life. The assumption is that there is an actual trespass by a member or officer of the court. The first step, verse 15, is to confront the person with their trespass in terms of God's law. Do they know the law of God? Are they ready to submit to it? If they do submit to the law of God, then indeed they are the Lord. Second, if they neglect the word and refuse to hear it, their refusal is to be confirmed in the mouth of at least one other witness, so that at least two witnesses can testify to their apostasy and or unbelief, verse 16. The reference here again is to the law of God. An offense against it or a rebuke in terms of that law and a failure to accept that law. The third step is to declare the unwillingness of the guilty party to the church. But if you neglect to hear the church, let him be unto thee a heathen and a publican, verse 17. The only possible judicial process which can take place in this third stage is if the accused party denies that the charges are true. A hearing then can determine whether the charges are true or false. That is, if God's law has been transgressed, failure by any party to accept God's law must lead to a break with him to excommunication. He is to be regarded as a heathen or a publican. The premise and ground of the authority of the individual confronts the guilty party and the church in its excommunicating power is the law word of God. In other words, it's not a Roman Catholic authority of the elder. It's because people have disobeyed the word. When men bind on where men bind on earth, the consciences of men and faithfulness to that word, their actions are valid in heaven. Where in faithfulness to that word, they forgive men on repentance and restitution, whom they loose on earth is loosed in heaven, verses 18 and 19. This authority is ministerial, not legislative. That is, man is bound to God's word, not God to man's word. Where men act in faithfulness to God's word, there he can fully expect God's supporting faithfulness. Verse 20, for where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. The primary reference here is the judicial acts of chastisement and forgiveness, but the reference is also general so that when whatever believers and churches do in faithfulness to the law word of God, they can then count on the present supporting and overruling power of the Lord himself. That's an excellent quote, fully biblical. The purpose of discipline is not simply to punish the guilty sinner. It's not, oh, you rotten bum, I'm going to get you. It's not just for punishment. It is to cause him to learn and take seriously the meaning of scriptures applied to him. What is discipline in essence? Well, the dictionary definition is that discipline is systematic training and submission to authority and the result of such training. It should be added that discipline comes from disciple, which in the Latin word discipulus, in turn derived from disco, to learn. To be a disciple and to be under discipline is to be a learner in a learning process. If there is no learning and no growth in learning, there is no discipline. If the excommunicated person does not repent and is not restored to the fellowship of the saints, he has not learned, and thus only awaits the punishment of everlasting fire on the final day. Okay, the goal of discipline is repentance. The goal of discipline is to learn from what you did wrong and repent and make amends. That church discipline is remedial and not simply a punishment is proved by Paul's statement in 1 Corinthians 5, 4-5. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, when you have gathered together along with my spirit with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ, deliver such a one over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, in order that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. Remedial. We're doing this to save him. Although a number of commentators view the destruction of the flesh as meaning death or a curse, that is not the best interpretation. And here's a quote from Chiampa and Rosner, which is just wonderful, on this passage. To hand the man over to Satan is to turn him back over to Satan's fear, outside the edifying and caring environment of the church where God is at work. In other words, verse 5 states metaphorically what Paul says literally in verses 2 and 13. The man is to be excluded from the community of faith. A similar metaphorical elaboration is given in verse 7 with the words, get rid of the old yeast. The destruction of the flesh refers not to his death, but to turning from evil desires, from his self-sufficiency, the destruction of the sinful nature. That a strong term like destruction can be employed metaphorically, especially in reference to flesh, is clear from Romans 8:13. Do not live according to the flesh, but instead put to death the misdeeds of the body. Galatians 5:24, crucify the flesh, and Colossians 3:5, put to death whatever belongs to the flesh. When Paul contrasts flesh and spirit, as here in verse 5, flesh refers almost without exception to the corrupt, fallen, and rebellious condition of the human being. As in Romans 8, 5-17 and Galatians 5, 16-24, flesh refers to the person oriented away from God and spirit to the person oriented toward God, or the Holy Spirit, as some commentators say. The man viewed as an enmity with God is to be destroyed. The man viewed as an enmity with God is to be destroyed. The resemblance of verse 5 to ancient curse formulas is only superficial. The closest parallels are Old Testament formulas using the terms to drive out and to cut off. Second Temple Judaism regularly replaced execution with excommunication when applying these texts to their communities. Job 1:12 and 2:6 may be a parallel, where Job is handed over to Satan, in which case suffering led to a positive result and the loss of life was specifically excluded. Acts 5:1-11 and 1 Corinthians 11:30 do report cases of what might be called capital punishment, but neither is a result of a solemn curse delivered by an assembled church. Finally, Satan's role in serving God's purpose is not out of keeping with Paul's understanding. Satan's messenger in 2 Corinthians 12:7 led to Paul's learning about the sufficiency of God's grace. As Finley states, that Satan's malignancy should be, as one may say, overreached by God's wisdom and mercy is nothing very wonderful. It's nothing very wonderful. Hate is providentially blind. It is not that Satan will not inflict the man with suffering. If he does, unwillingly and ironically, the suffering will be, as Paul hopes, remedial. That the man in 1 Corinthians 5 is not expected to die at least immediately is clear from verse 11, where the Corinthians are told to not to associate with him, and from 1 Timothy 1:19 to 20, where Hymenaeus and Alexander are handed over to Satan to be taught not to blaspheme, that is, to change their behavior. In our view, the incestuous man was handed over to Satan to be taught not to commit sexual immorality, end of quote. Now, if 2 Corinthians 2:5 and following is speaking about the same man, the excommunication had the intended effect. It sanctified him. It taught him a lesson. It taught him to obey the word of God. It had the sanctifying effect intended. Paul tells the congregation to receive the repentant offender with kindness and not to be cold or standoffish with him. The church is a family, and repentant persons must be welcomed back in the fold with true forgiveness and love. And this is a really sick, pretty sick sin. I mean, this is an incest with his mother. Probably his mother-in-law, but it was incest. This is a requirement. It is not optional. So if somebody does some, even a serious sin, but they truly repent and are restored, they have to be treated with love and not with hate. The exercising of biblical church discipline is crucial to the health of the church and is required by Scripture for three main reasons, just very briefly. Number one, those who break the covenant law through immorality or dangerous heresy are to be cut off from the covenant community. We find that throughout the Bible, especially in the Old Testament. To refuse to clear out false prophets or habitual immoral persons will place the whole covenant community in danger of covenant sanctions. If somebody's in deep sin and the church knows about it, they don't do anything, they're held responsible to a degree. Number two, it is necessary for the maintenance of holiness and orthodoxy. Paul says, this is from 1 Corinthians 6, 6 to 7a, do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? Therefore, purge out the old leaven. So this attitude, well, we can tolerate a little heresy. We can tolerate a little corruption. We want to be big. You're small. We don't recognize you. You're too small. But we're big because we tolerate six different views of Genesis 1 and 2. We tolerate heretical nonsense on justification by faith. We tolerate perverted views of the law. We tolerate all Sabbath breaking and all sorts of crazy things. No, that's totally an unbiblical attitude. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. It's dangerous to leave leaven in there. Therefore, purge out the old leaven, Paul says. Speaking of doctrine, Jesus told his disciples, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. Once a bad behavior or a bad doctrine is tolerated by the church, it then becomes accepted. And finally, even defended by the leaders of the church. And I remind you of the case in a Southern Presbytery of the PCA where they refused to license a man to gospel ministry because he believed he had a strict Sabbatarian view. And they voted not to license him because he would offend people. Because in the PCA, we don't discipline people if they break the Sabbath. The leaven leavened the lump, didn't it? Bad behavior or bad doctrine is tolerated, it becomes accepted, and finally even defended by the leaders of the church. Number three. Closely related to the first point is guilt by association. If unbiblical behavior or doctrine is tolerated by the elders and the congregation, then they are given their implicit approval of that behavior and thus are guilty themselves. On a broader cultural level, Paul says this. Now, this is an application. This is not speaking to the same thing, but it's an application. Romans 1:32. Knowing the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are deserving of death. Now, listen to Paul. Not only who do the same, but also approve of those who practice them. The men of the Supreme Court, they're not out there cutting babies' heads off and sucking them out with a vacuum. But they're guilty. because they approve of it, and they let it be. Presbyterian church government is a wonderful gift of God that, if carefully and biblically applied, should maintain the peace, purity, and orthodoxy of the church. The fact that the system has been abused, perverted, and misapplied is no reason to criticize this God-ordained system of government. Yeah, the church is full of sinners. The church has done many stupid things. But it's not the Word of God's fault. It's not Christ's fault. It's not the Holy Spirit's fault. It's our fault. This system is excellent. But the ones in positions of authority are still sinners and are often ignorant. The solution to covenant abuses is repentance, not turning to pragmatism. Not saying, oh, well, it didn't work. We're going to do this. No, it didn't work because of you, not because of the Bible. So let us all return to biblical Presbyterian church government and do so biblically. And we'll have better churches for it. We'll have more unity. We'll have more peace. We'll have doctrinal purity. We'll have more ethical purity. And we need to avoid Pharisaicalism and refusing to forgive people and love people who have truly repented. A lot of people who think they're the strictest Presbyterians are just legalistic jerks. They're nothing but Pharisees, self-righteous bigots who need to be disciplined themselves. Let us pray. Father, we come before your throne giving you great thanks for your word and your son. We thank you for Presbyterian church government because it is the most biblical, the only biblical system. And it really works when we do it biblically. We thank you for it, Lord. We ask that you would revive it and revive the true practice of it among Presbyterians and bring reformation to Presbyterian churches today, that they would once again worship you in spirit and truth and place your word and our standards, which are in agreement with your word, before pragmatism and this desire to be big. In Jesus' name.